please close your eyes. Open the eyes of your soul. You are leaning over God, and you see a square hole. On the four corners of the hole are four beautiful faces. The faces of people who love you enough to do what is impossible, to climb the roof, and to bring you to Jesus. And as you are being lowered down, gradually, suddenly, there is a face that is smiling before you. A face that is full of delight. A face that looks at you with mercy and compassion. A face that says, "My son, your sins are forgiven." Okay, let me open your eyes now. Did you see it? Thank you. That's really the scriptures with imagination. If you want to be able to appreciate scriptures, read with imagination. Find a picture. Be a participant. Your sins are forgiven. That's the joy of the gospel. The joy of the gospel. And Jesus says, people began to murmur and says, "Who is this man? How dare this man forgive sins? Who can forgive sins except God alone?" And Jesus said, "Why? Why are you murmuring? Well, which do you think is much easier to say? Your sins are forgiven? Or stand up and walk?" Well, actually, it's more difficult to say stand up and walk, because if Jesus says stand up and walk, and the guy doesn't walk, he's in trouble. But if Jesus says your sins are forgiven, nobody knows. It's between him and God, right? But he says, well, it would have been easier to say your sins are forgiven. But now he says, listen to this. I command you, stand up, pick up your mats, and go home. And the man stood up, picked up his mat, and went home. A proof that indeed his sins, the sins that have been paralyzing him all these years, had truly been forgiven. Now the joy of the gospel makes him walk again. Next, please speak. Just one night. And you know who Jesus said it to? To the leper. Imagine now that you're the leper. And there is something very strange happening here. Because in the Gospel of Mark, we're told that Jesus met the man in town. The lepers have no business going into town. Because they're supposed to be unclean. They're supposed to go to the wilderness. What is this man doing in town? If, you know, if anybody found out that this leper was in town, it takes only one shout from a citizen of the town to say, "There is a leper, there is a leper." And they would get stones, and they would stone him to death. Because he's not supposed to be in town. He's supposed to be out in the desert. But you know, Jesus has met many of these people out in the desert because he loved to go to the wilderness to pray. I think he had met this man before. I think he knew this man. And so this man, what was he doing in town? I have a theory. This man had been missing his sanity. And so one day, he decided to cover himself, to sneak into town, and from a distance, look at his sanity. Just a glance, just a glimpse of his wife and his children whom he could not touch anymore. All he wanted was a little glimpse. Unfortunately for him, he was seen by somebody who recognized him. But fortunately for him, that somebody was not a man who was going to swim. It was not a man who was going to stone him to death. And when they met each other, he was swimming, of course. I think what he wanted to say was, "Please don't shout, don't shout. don't give me alms. But what came out of his mouth instead was, if you will to do so, you can make me clean. And the Lord touched him, which is not supposed to do. He touched him. And suddenly the man got cured. Because the Lord said, I do will it, be made clean. That's the joy of the gospel. Just that man, I do will it. God wills it, be made clean. Next slide, please, read. Now imagine that you are the woman with hemorrhage. You have been waiting for 12 years. You have been waiting for 12 years. And you heard that this man Jesus could heal people. But there was a big crowd of people. And there is an emergency situation. There is a man named Jairus, who is a synagogue official, who came to Jesus and said, please, Lord, my daughter is very sick. Come with me. And the Lord said, all right, let's go. And while they were going, there was a traffic. Have you ever experienced being in an emergency situation and suddenly there is traffic? My God, that's horrible. And I think Jairus was in a state of panic. He was in a state of panic because his daughter was dying. Remember how old the daughter was? 12 years old. And then suddenly Jesus was looking around and he was saying, who touched my garments? You know, I think Jairus was getting angry already. I think Jairus was saying, touch your garment! Don't you see everybody is pressing in on you and you say, who touched your garment? Lord, please! As they would say in Tagalog, kung pwede lang ang alat ka rin, kilalat ka lang niya si Jesus. Because emergency. But you know, I think Jesus allowed himself to be delayed. Because he had a message to Jairus. It was his way of saying, Jairus, okay, I know you are in need. But you see this woman? She has been waiting for 12 years. Exactly the age of your daughter. You know, when you are in a state of need, you think you're the only person in need, and you forget about the rest of the world. That is why Jesus allowed himself to be delayed. And sure enough, he was delayed, the daughter died. But somebody heard the good news. The woman with hemorrhage. Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease. Yes, it was good news to the woman with hemorrhage, but it was bad news for Jairus. Because somebody came and said, do not bother the master, your daughter is dead already. And he would have given up. Good thing Jesus said, no, just have faith. Just have faith. Let's go. And they continued on. And you know the rest of the story. It was also good news for Jairus, nevertheless. Little daughter, arise. Next, read it together. Do not
be afraid.
Okay, imagine yourself with the disciples in the boat. The boat is sinking. You know that game? You see, it's not as simple as that. You cannot even do any grouping anymore when the boat is sinking. Jesus was left praying alone. And they went to the boat and suddenly there was a storm at sea. The boat was sinking. And then they saw a man who was walking on the water. He was even going to overtake them. And I think he said, hi guys. Just like that. And they were scared because they thought they were seeing a ghost. He was trying to calm them down. Come on. What's the big deal about the storm? Walk on it. Walk on it. Do not be afraid. It is time. you are in the same panic yourself and you feel that you're sinking, then please speak the good news. Do not be afraid. It is I. Next. Together. Hold on. Imagine that you are the tax collectors and sinners whom Jesus is hobnobbing with, whom Jesus is having dinner with. And the killjoys who are the Pharisees and the scribes are murdering. And now Jesus gave three parables: the lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son. And he gives as a constant refrain the joy of the gospel. There will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous people who need no repentance. Next, together. Imagine that you are the thief hanging on the cross. You know that you are doomed and that you're going to hell, surely going to hell, because you have committed a lot of crimes. And at the last minute you acknowledge, because you saw this man as a righteous man. He had not committed anything wrong, but he is suffering. And so you look at him and you say, Jesus, would you please remember me when you are in paradise? Because I know there's no way that I can get into paradise. I'm not sure because you're a good man, you're going there. Just please remember me. That's enough for me. And suddenly, the man looked at you, his bloody face, and the gentle eyes, with the same sparkle, said, today, you will be with me in paradise. Isn't that a liberating good news? Wow! I wish to hear that from Jesus. Next, together. Well, imagine that you are a foreigner. She is called a Syrophoenician. She is called a Canaanite in the Gospel of Matthew. But the basic thing is, you're a foreigner. You have no rights. She does not even believe in Yahweh. What is she? A pagan. A pagan. But she intercedes for her daughter. You see, it's not only the Yahweh believers who will do what they can to save the daughter. Even non-believers love their children. Even people of other religions will love. And so this woman came to Jesus. And the disciples were chewing her like the children. I think they were saying, get out of here, get out of here. What do you think you are? You're not even Israelite. You're not even a Jew. How dare you? How dare you mix with our company? Get out of here. And you know for a while Jesus was even influenced by them. Just destroy. Please tell her to get out of here. And Jesus tested her and said, you know, it's not good to take food from the table and throw it to the dogs. Wow, what an insult. She could have gotten angry. That sounded like bad news. She could have reacted and said, how dare you insult me? No. She reacted with humility. She's not claiming a right. She's not claiming an entitlement. And you know, it is people who do not claim a right to grace who are bound to experience the joy of the gospel. She said, Lord, even the dogs eat from the scraps that fall from the master's table. And Jesus smiled and said to the woman, woman, how great is your faith? Aren't you surprised by that? Great is your faith. Great is your faith. She's not even a believer. She's a pagan. What faith is Jesus talking about here? But Jesus recognizes faith in the woman. I think what Jesus meant was, how great is your love? Because she was willing to endure insult for the sake of her dying daughter. How great is your love? Remember, Paul says the greatest gifts. What are the great gifts? Faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of them is? Not faith. Not faith. So don't you make a big deal of your faith, okay? It's love. You remove the love, you don't have faith. The greatest is love. And Jesus recognized that love with this woman that is now making her a believer because she's recognizing Jesus, her Savior. Great is your faith, and she gets what she wants. It's the joy of the gospel. Next, together. Oh, you heard that already. Because you have been listening to the Beatitudes. Actually, he said it to the poor. How blessed are you who are poor? Do you believe that? My goodness, is the time when Jesus, the poor, believed that they were cursed. Poverty was regarded as a curse. And then now, you hear it from Jesus. How blessed are you who are poor? The kingdom of God is yours. Next. Oh, there are many of these people who look miserable. And I think many of them were Pharisees and scribes. They were joyless. They were always bent on imposing obligations. I think they wanted other people to be miserable because they were themselves miserable. And so Jesus said, come to me, all of you who labor and are burdened, and I will. Is this not good news? Well, this is for all who are miserable. But first, Jesus will try to lead you to understanding where your wisdom comes from. So good news.